We shall have a reading from the scriptures. Sister Noela will help us.
This is reading is taken from the book of Ephesians, chapter 1, verses 1 to 8. Ephesians, chapter 1, verses 1 to 8. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the saints which are in Ephesus, and to the faithful in Christ Jesus, grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who had blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he had chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he had made us accepted in the beloved, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace, wherein he had abounded towards us in all wisdom and prudence. Here ends the Bible reading.
Praise be to the Lord's holy name. The caption for this morning meditation is Praise to Glory of Grace. Praise to Glory of Grace. Ephesians chapter 1, we have the reading from verse 1 to 8 and the first three verses from the salutation and the prologue for that epistle. And from verse 4, God's a very high plan for mankind in nutshell revealed. From verse 4 to 8, God's great plan for mankind in a nutshell revealed. I just read from verse 4 again. According as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, he has chosen us even before the foundation of the world. Why? That we should be holy and without blame before him in love. We should be holy in love, and we should be without blame before him in love, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children. He has predestinated us unto the adoption to make us his own children by Christ, or in Christ, to himself, to make us his own children in him, according to the good pleasure of his will. It is a good pleasure of his will to own us, to adopt us as his own children, in whom, as in Christ, we have redemption through his blood, through the blood of Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. One of the most difficult passages ever I had in preparing God's word to the church. It seemed to be relatively simple to understand that passage, but it appeared to be a Himalayan task to bring a sermon out of this passage. So I was reading this passage again and again and again and again. So the points are given by the Lord, power is given by the Lord, I am doing the presentation. With the grace that is bestowed upon me, I am organizing this as a teaching material for you. Number one, I want to show to you God's predetermination, God's pre-plan, predestination. In verse 5, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to Himself. So many a time we can't understand everything. Why has God predestinated me unto the adoption of a child by Jesus Christ to Himself? I may not fully understand. Why I, not somebody else? Why has He chosen me? I don't understand. I accept. See, the greatest understanding is when we understand that we cannot understand, we understand. Let me repeat it. When we understand that we cannot understand, we understand. See, about eternity, the past eternity, the future eternity, God's predestination, why am I chosen? Why am I saved? Why somebody else is not saved? Why am I still alive? Why am I not dead when somebody died? When somebody gets cancer, why don't I get cancer? Why I get cancer? Can anybody give an answer to this? The other day somebody has done philosophy. He thought that he was thinking in a philosophic way. Philosophy means love for wisdom. Philo means love, Sophie means wisdom. Or absolute, ultimate. So apparently he had some interest for ultimate. And he had a lot of negative thoughts because of his learning. He said, why all this evil happening in this world? Why so many people are killed in a very cruel way? He asked a number of questions. He was very sure that there will be no answer for those questions. His conclusion, God is cruel. He believed in God, but he thought that God was cruel. I asked him a question. See, one street dog, a stray dog, could not even get a rusk or a purra. People are stoning at the dog. They are hitting the dog. The tea shop wala pour hot water on it. And another dog is enjoying royal petting and pampering. Why? Why is this dog suffering? Why is that dog blessed? Sir, I don't know. I don't know. When you understand that you can't understand, you'll understand. All the more you try to find out, why is this dog suffering, why that dog is not suffering? You may not get an answer. Not only for living things, even for non-living things. My dear brother, my dear sister, I asked him, if you say that God is cruel, then that God cannot be God. God must be good. When you say this God is cruel, then find out God who is not cruel. We believe God is good. we believe God is right. My dear brother, my dear sister, the Bible is not trying to prove who God is. The Bible is not trying to prove that God is always good. The Bible says, God created heaven and the earth. It's not trying to prove who God was. The Bible was not trying to prove what God was doing before He created heaven and the earth. What was the work of God? What was the function of God before He created heaven and the earth? Can anybody find an answer to that? If you say there is no God, without creator, there will be no creation. Without a producer, there will be no product. There will be no production. So there must have been a creator. He created all things for His own pleasure, we don't know. But we believe that creator is good. If that creator is bad, He cannot be God. My dear brother, my dear sister, so we should believe this God predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to Himself, according to the good pleasure of His will, not because I desired. It's because He desired. Why did He desire? I don't know. But I believe. Today I am a child of God. Today I am traversing this path. It is His predetermination. What was His predetermination? That I should be His own child. I should be His own child. What do we call that? It is His grace. It is His grace. Why did He call Abraham? Nobody else in Babylon? Why did He call Abraham? Abraham is not by any yardstick today a totally virtuous man. There was disobedience in him. There was a lie in him. He was working against God's plan in his life. There are many pitfalls. Now why did God call Abraham? He asked Abraham, Abraham, why did God call you? Abraham was not like maybe Abel, not like Enoch, even not like Noah. Noah was righteous in all the people of his days. But about Abraham it is not said like that. He was righteous in all people of his days. He was an ordinary man. Abraham could say, I don't know. Why did you call Abraham? Why did God call you Abraham? I don't know. What's the special God found in you? I don't know. It's not because there were some special traits in Abraham. But even not because of his special traits. God's choice. Jacob, God's choice. David, God's choice. Joseph, God's choice. Moses, God's choice. Coming to the New Testament, why did God choose Mary? Anything very special? True, she is really a woman blessed with grace. Not because of her chastity, I'm not questioning her chastity, but I don't say there's no chaste woman in Tamil Nadu. Not because there's no other chaste woman in any part of the world. Why did God choose Mary? What was God's plan? No, the younger virtuous, chaste? Is there any Bible record or a historical record? Only one thing. With a false human understanding, God was formed in her womb because she was immaculate. The Bible doesn't say that she was immaculate. If Mary was immaculate, for Mary to be born immaculate, Mary's mother must be immaculate. If Mary has to be immaculate, to give birth to an immaculate child, her mother must be immaculate, her grandmother must be immaculate, that's impossible. Mary was an ordinary person. She found grace in the eyes of God. It's the grace of God. It is the grace of God. So we cannot fully understand why Mary. You ask 100 times, you can't find an answer. The best thing that I understand that I can't understand. But I accept. The only one way I can understand it is God's grace, God's selection. In every situation we can say that. God wants to feed Elijah. God could have sent some eagle, the king of fowls. Elijah could be proud of it. Eagles brought my food. Or God could have sent some peacock. The gracious dawns of the peacock could have revived the heart of Elijah. Or he could have sent some cuckoo birds. Or at least he could have sent some doves. Clean bird. Why did he send ravens? Not even crows. Ravens generally live in graveyards, cremation places. They are defiled animals. And why should God choose ravens? If you say, no, I can find an answer. If it is eagle, you can say the reason. If it's a dove, you may say a reason. If a peacock, you may say a reason. Even if it is a nightingale, you can say a reason. Yes, for raven, I can say a reason. It is grace. I know it is grace, his predestination. My dear brother, my dear sister, it's not totally to say that I don't understand. Now I understand that it is grace. So there's the first part. God has got a plan for you and I. God has got a plan for you and I. We should become the child of God. That Christu Jayanti, what the world called with a misnomer Christmas, is not that God became man. The real story of Christu Jayanti is man becoming God. Man becoming God. Not God becoming man. Man becoming God. Jesus came into this world not just to give up his godliness and take up human form. Jesus came into this world to give us God form. When we believe in his name and when we receive him as our personal savior, we'll be born of God. Will be a new creation, God being. Will be a new creation, God being. He created man and he rested. No more creation. He made the light to come. The birds, animals, reptiles, everything. Finally, he created man and rested. There's the last and final creation. Then what's the new creation? It's not an animal, it's not a reptile, it's not a bird, it's not a man. In the new creation is God being. So that is the purpose, his plan. My dear brother, my dear sister, the Bible reveals that to us. That's why it's called Marai Moli, Marai Nool. Marai Nool doesn't mean hide everything, it reveals to us the hidden things. So first thing, he has predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. That is his grace. And number two, we read in verse 4, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, according as he hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. So if it is his idea that I should be his own child, I should be holy, holy in love. My holiness is without any deception. My love should be holy. There is nothing unholy in my love. That is agapeos. Loving has become my nature. Unfeigned love. Mayamatta snake. Mayamatta anbu. You love your wife because you expect something from her. That's not real love. You love your wife, you show your love to your wife because you expect something. Something you expect. Maybe a sexual gratification, or a good food, or somebody to cook for you, somebody to clean your clothes, wash your clothes, somebody to look after your children. You love that person. That is a feigned love. Mayamulla anbu. Because you get something, or you want to get something, you show some pretentious love. You love your husband. You love him because there's nothing else you can do. Maybe again, for your needs to be met with, for you to have a lifestyle, for your children to have a father, for you to have an initial or a surname, okay, you love him. You love anybody. There is a hidden agenda behind it, that's not the true love. Your love must be holy. There is no tag attached to it. Your nature is loving, that's all, you love. Wife is a good wife or a bad wife, you love her. Your child is a good child or a bad child, you love him. Your nature is loving. Why do you love your enemy? My nature is loving. Loving is not static, loving is always kinetic. You exhibit your love. Love does something. Love does something. You should be holy in love without blame. Nobody should find a blame in your love. Your love is not, I'm not talking about a youthful lust. Today they call it a love, love, love. According to the Bible, that youthful lust is not a love. youthful lust is not allowed. Don't mix it. Don't call that punidam. Any man, woman love outside marriage, the best Tamil word is kallakadal. Love within the marriage is nallakadal. Love outside marriage is kallakadal. Whether you are a married person or not. There are only two, either nallakadal or kallakadal. My dear brother, my dear sister, love within marriage is nallakadal. That's a pure eros. But agapeo is entirely different. His desire that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. So that is the purpose with which he is working in us. He gives you job, he brings you to a church, he gives you revelation, he changes your character, he uses you in the ministry. You may go through a path of privation, suffering. Every situation, toils, dangers, hardships, every situation he permits in our life, because it is his purpose, as his child, I should be holy and be without blame before him in love. So he is working in me. So he has chosen me to be his child, and as his child I should be holy and without blame in love. He is working in me. How does he work in me? Verse 6. To the praise of the glory of his grace wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved. So what he has done in Christ, in the beloved, Christ. Christ is God manifest in flesh. So God that was manifest in flesh, in that Godhead. So for me to become a child of God, for me to become a God being, he starts working in himself, in Jesus Christ. In Jesus Christ, he has made us accepted. What does it actually mean? He had made us accepted. He has made us accepted. Acceptable to God. A standard that is acceptable to God in Christ Jesus. But literally, in him, he graced us. He graced us. The divine nature he has given us. In him graced us. To the praise of the glory of his grace. So what he does, his idea is to make us his child. For us to become his child, we should be holy and without blame before him in love. So what can I do? He graced us. He has given abundance of grace to us. Made us accepted in the beloved. In Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is Godhead. In Godhead, in God's nature, he given us a lot of grace. He graced us. And to the praise of glory of that grace, we can become his child. How can we become his child? We'll become holy and without blame in love, and we'll become his child. How is that possible? In his beloved, in Christ, In God who was revealed in God who was manifest in flesh, in that God, He graced me. And I will be, in all its meaning, the child of God. I will be like Him. I will be equal to Him one day. How is that possible? It is to the praise of the glory of grace. I know, Paul cannot write it from his intellect unless God put these words in his mouth. Unless God has put words in his mouth, Paul cannot write this. So what is grace? I was trying to explain this earlier, last 2 weeks. Grace is a very simple thing. It is a divine, holy influence in our soul that kindles our spirit. Grace turns us to God, turns us to Christ. We receive Jesus Christ, our Savior. We come into Christ. That grace teaches us what we should do, what we should not do. That grace teaches us. That grace gives us a love for the Word of God. And the Word of God becomes flesh. More and more we become divine. Divinity is not in performing miracle. Divinity is God's nature in our life. We more and more get God's nature in your life. More and more people begin to see God in us. Our neighbors tell us, Ni unmaya deva paravi. நீ தான் தேவனுடைய நீ தேவன் தான் காண்டவர் தான் உன் ரூபத்தில் வந்து இதை சொன்னார். யுவர் கலீக்ஸ் வில் சே, யுவர் ஃப்ரெண்ட்ஸ் வில் சே, ஒன்லி யூ காட் த ஸ்பிரிட் ஆஃப் காட் இன் யூ, தட்ஸ் வை ஆர் டூயிங் லைக் திஸ். அட்லீஸ்ட் 3 times இன் அ டே, அட்லீஸ்ட் 10 times இன் அ டே, 20 times இன் அ டே, யுவர் ரிலேட்டிவ்ஸ் பிகின் டு சே தட். உன்னை பேசினாலே சந்தோஷமாக இருக்கு. நீ வீட்டுக்கு வந்துட்டு போன ஒரு ஏஞ்சல் வந்துட்டு போன மாதிரி இருக்குது. மோர் அண்ட் மோர், மோர் அண்ட் மோர், மோர் அண்ட் மோர் பீப்புள் பிகின் டு சீ காட் இன் யூ. பீப்புள் பிகின் டு சீ டிவினிட்டி இன் யூ. ஃபார் சம் பீப்புள் தே சே, ஐயோ அது பேய் பிசாஸ், பார்த்தாலே பயமாக இருக்கு. கொஞ்சம் நேரம் பேச ஆரம்பிச்சா சண்டை வந்துடும். My dear brother, my dear sister, it is to the work of glory, of grace in our life. It turns us more and more to God. It teaches us what we should do, what we should not do. The nature of Christ is more formed in us. It is the work of the grace in our life. It's an influence. It's a divine holy influence. It's not my own desire. My carnal man, he wants to take revenge. He wants to take revenge. My carnal man is happy about the revenge. But that is a divine nature. There's a divine nature. Think about it. How will it come? It's work of the Holy Spirit, the grace of God operating in our life. More grace, more divine nature. More grace, more divine nature. How God would think in that situation, I'd begin to think. So that is the work of grace in our lives. It influences our soul, our look, our words, our style, everything changes. Now what happened? The fourth one, in whom we have redemption through His blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of His grace. So God has got an idea that I should become His child. If I have to become His child, I must be holy and without blame before Him in love. So He imparts grace, grace upon grace. It's a holy influence in my spirit, my soul, that quickens my spirit and turns me to Jesus Christ. When it turns me to Jesus Christ because of the riches of His grace, because of the riches of His grace, I have redemption through His blood, through the blood of Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of sins. So two things happened. One is, sin in a singular way. It is, I am a sinner because of the sin of disobedience of Adam. Disobedience of Adam is nothing but my own disobedience. I was in Adam. When Adam was eating that fruit, biologically I was in his blood. I was eating that fruit. Though I haven't transgressed to the similitude of Adam. God told Adam not to eat that fruit, Adam ate. Even to that extent I have not transgressed. But that sin is on me, the death is on me. Because in Adam I transgressed. It's because I ate that fruit. It's not Adam ate that fruit. Where was I when Adam was eating that fruit? Where was Cain? Cain was in his blood. Where was Abel? Abel was in his blood. Where was Noah? Noah was in his blood. Where was Abraham? Abraham was in his blood. Everybody was in the bloodstream of Adam. Of all who are born in this world except Jesus Christ. He was not born of a man. All the others, we all got the blood of Adam. We all transgressed. That is sin. So He delivers us from that sin, and because we are sinners, we have sinned. Many sins we have done. I always give this proposition. We don't become sinners because we sin. We don't become sinners because we sin. Whether we sin or we sin not, we are sinners. Because we are sinners, we sin. We commit many sins. Whether we sin or not, we are sinners. Because we are sinners, we sin. Many years back, the time that I got saved, when I was sharing this proposition, one great psychologist, he contradicted me and said, no, you people talk rubbish, you people talk about a genetic sin, there's no genetic sin. It's only we sin as we grow in this world. I said, sir, I give an illustration. A father is bringing some, that mixer, kara mixer, home. They divide it into four parts. There's a boy 3 years old. When he wants to take his share, he takes one groundnut from his sister's share. Who taught that boy to take a groundnut from his sister? Why is he so greedy? When that boy grows, he will take half a foot land from his sister. Grab half a foot land from his sister. Nobody taught him, it is in him. A boy is 1 year, 1.5 years old. The second child is born. The mother is always lying with the second child. When daddy comes back home, he just goes straight to the second child, the newborn, plays with that child. Every uncle, auntie, every friend coming home buys a gift for the newborn. The 1.5-year-old child gets jealousy. And nobody is there. This child, in its own strength, wants to destroy that child. Nobody taught the child to murder. Hits the child. Pulls the child by the hand. The only one desire, to destroy that newcomer. To destroy that newcomer in its own way. He said, yes, Mr. Simon, I see some reason in what you are saying. This is not today. Maybe 40 years back, I discussed this with him. Because we are sinners, when time comes, we sin. You're hitting your wife. You're hitting your child. A bad hit could have made you a murderer. You lust another woman. You lust another man's wife. At a bad moment, because of heat, you could have become an adulterer. You could have committed adultery. No adulterer can go to heaven. Even ordinary liar, one who lies is a liar. Poi pesaravan poiyen. Poi pesaravan to poiye. Ni poiyen apdin sonna unukkuvar. நீ பொய்யன் அப்படின்னு சொன்னால் கோபம் வரும். பொய் பேசுறது தான் நான் பொய்யன். சும்மா பொய் சொன்னேன், அதான் நான் பொய்யனா? பொய் பேசுகிறவன் பொய்யன், கொலை செய்கிறவன் கொலைகாரன், விபச்சாரம் செய்கிறவன் விபச்சாரன், விபச்சாரக்காரன் விபச்சாரிக்காரி. That's what Jesus said, even if you lust in your heart, you are committed already adultery. Because you are an adulterer, when time comes you commit adultery. ஒரு விபச்சார காரணம் இருக்கிறபடியினாலே நேரம் வாய்க்கும் போது விபச்சாரம் செய்கிறான். விபச்சாரம் செய்கிறதுனாலே விபச்சார காரணமாக மாறுவதில்லை. To explain, I give a small example. Somebody is very angry, got his pistol, shot at the other person. The other person dies. He is a murderer. He is a murderer. The court would convict him a murderer. We understand. This man gets angry. He shoots at the other person. His aim is bad. The other person is very clever, he ducked fast, he is not killed. The world will not say he is a murderer, But according to the Bible, he is a murderer. Murderer who didn't know to murder, that's all. A murderer who is bad at his aim. A murderer, his victim was smart. He is a murderer. The other person didn't die. The other person didn't die. Because you are a murderer, you try to murder. Whether you murdered or not murdered, you are a murderer. Whether you committed adultery or not, if you give room for the lust, you are an adulterer. When the time comes, you may commit adultery. Some of you might not have committed adultery because of the fear of the society. Some of you might not have committed adultery because of the fear of the hellfire, because of your family brought up, maybe because you don't have the guts to do it, and maybe because you don't have anybody to cooperate with you, not because you are a goody-goody person. So now, we all are sinners and we have committed many sins. But God has planned this bunch of sinners who have committed many sins to become His child. So He forgives all of our sins. Not only He forgives all of our sins, He gives us redemption, bringing us out of that miry clay, from the clutches of sin, from the desire to sin, from the nature to sin. That's the work of the Holy Spirit in our life. Had it not been, you'll go to the hellfire as an adulterer, as a murderer, as a woman monger, thief, rogue. It is the mercy of God that brings you out of that, out of the clutches of sin, the riches of His grace, the riches. We say rich plum, rich cream, rich grace. That alone can bring us from the snare of sin. And finally, when we wretched people, He has chosen us, He has predestined us to be His children, He works in our lives, He forgives us our sin, and when we could become the child of God, that brings praise to the glory. But how does it happen? Just we go to verse 8 and before I conclude. Wherein He hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. Wherein? In that grace. He hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. Heavenly wisdom. With heavenly intelligence. I should not do this. I should say no to that. The grace teaches me. Say no to worldliness. Say no to something ungodly. Live righteous. It teaches me. It gives me wisdom. It gives me prudence more and more, more and more, more and more, and makes me look forward to the appearance of this glorious Jesus, because He has redeemed me from all iniquity. He has purified me. So more and more, more and more, more and more, I wait for His coming. Glory be to the Lord's holy name. My dear brother, my dear sister, how could we become a child of God? That is to the praise of the glory of His grace. More and more grace is given, more wisdom, more intelligence, more understanding. I should not speak like this to my wife. I should love my enemy. I should not hate this. I should say no to worldliness. I am intelligent enough. It is not necessary. What is I am going to do with all this money? I must use it for the spread of the kingdom of God. I must be able to deliver at least some people from the fiery clay. I get my own understanding. I get my own intelligence, heavenly knowledge, heavenly understanding. That brings me more and more and more closer to God. And when I become like God's child, that is to the praise of the glory of grace. Glory of grace means the characteristics of grace. Grace, glory means it seems that it appears. Glory of grace means it seems that really grace is in me. That's why I'm able to forgive my enemy. That's why I'm able to love them that hate me. That's why I'm able to say no to worldliness. That's why I'm able to say no to ungodliness. Because that grace is in me. When it appears that grace is in me, that is the glory of grace. That's the glory of grace, the characteristics of grace appearing in me. And to the praise of that glory, when I become like a child of God. So I just say one thing and conclude. A child coming from a very poor, rich family, father is a mathematician and mother was a math professor, and the child is very intelligent, very loving, wants to learn more. The child wants to excel his parents, very good in maths, and the house got every provision for learning. For the child, the parents help the child, and they got a special tuition, they got a room for the child. The child studies well, the child gets 100 out of 100. Really good. Just imagine another child. Comes from a slum area, parents don't want the child to go to school. If the child could go to work, it can earn at least a few paisa to the house. What's the use of going to school? The parents don't want to go to the school. That boy doesn't want to learn. He loves to play with other boys. He wants to be a vagabond. He doesn't like discipline. He doesn't like to sit in the school. The teacher showers his love on the child. Somehow brings the child to the school. One day he comes, 2 days he won't come. The teacher talks to the child. The child could not understand anything. Child is very rebellious. The teacher helps. The teacher influences his nature into that child, develops interest in mathematics. The child slowly started liking mathematics. The parents are not cooperative. The evening the child could not sit in the house and learn. There is no electricity. The teacher endures more and more. And one day, in the final examination, this child also gets 100. That is to the praise of the work of the teacher. That is to the praise of the work of that teacher. That teacher was able to make that child get 100. It's again the work of the teacher for the other child also. But it's not a big praise to him. But when this child gets 100, it is to the praise of that teacher. Similarly, when Robert could be in all its forms, in all its sense of that word, a child of God, because of the work of the grace, that is to the praise of that grace. அதான் கிருபைக்கு புகழ்ச்சி. ராபர்ட் தேவனை போல மாறும்போது கிருபைக்கு எவ்வளவு பவர் இருக்கு பத்தியா? கிருபை ராபர்ட்டையும் தேவனாய் மாற்றிட்டே அதுக்கு என்ன செய்கிறார்? கிருபையின் மேல் கிருபை, கிரேஸ் அப்பான் கிரேஸ், கிரேஸ் அப்பான் கிரேஸ். வென் தெர் இஸ் சின் மோர் கிரேஸ், வேர் தெர் இஸ் சின் மோர் கிரேஸ், மோர் சின் மோர் கிரேஸ். ஃபார் வாட்? என்னையும் தம்மை போல மாற்ற. அப்படி என்னை அவரை போல மாற்றும்போது, என்னையும் அவரை போல மாற்றும்போது, அவருடைய கிருபையின் மகிமைக்கு அது புகழ்ச்சியாக இருக்கும். இல்லைன்னா அந்த கிருபைக்கு வேல்யூவே கிடையாது. அந்த கிருபை எவ்வளவு பவர்ஃபுல், அந்த கிருபை எவ்வளவு பவர்ஃபுல் எப்போ தெரியும் தெரியுமா? When Robert could be the child of God in all its form. When I see him, I'll be like him. When I see him, I'll be like him. It is the work of the grace. When I will be like Jesus Christ, that reveals the power, such the praise of the glory of the grace. That grace operates in us. So God has got a great plan for you, that you should be the child of God. God works it in you. So God wants you to be holy and without blame in love. So He has given this grace to us. He imparts His grace in us. That grace delivers us not only from sin, but also from the forgiveness of all our sins. And with all intelligence and wisdom, He makes that grace abound toward us. Abound toward us. More and more, more and more. That brings the praise to the glory of His grace. When that purpose, the predestination is completed in us, surely that's the work of the grace in our lives. Shall we just commit ourselves into the hands of the Lord and pray, Lord, I commit myself into that grace. I don't know why You have chosen me, but I know that You have chosen me. For that high calling, for that holy calling, for that heavenly calling, otherwise I would not be here. I don't know, Lord, why You have chosen me, that's Your grace. Your eternal plan. I cannot understand it. But I commit myself to it. To every brother, every sister who is listening to me, the live streaming, in the name of Jesus, I request you. Commit to that grace. Don't resist that grace. A free will is given to us that we can resist that grace. I'm not getting into it today. The Lord has spoken to you. It is the grace that started this good work in you. It is the grace that continues that good work in you. It is the grace that will usher you into heaven. Dear Father God, we thank You, we praise You, we worship You for the grace that You have given us. And keep us in that grace and glorify Your matchless name in us, O Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.